author, social activist, gorgeous man, Rami Shamir. Hi there, Rami.
Hi, Gail. Thank you so much for having me on the show again. This time as someone who will be speaking about something other than what he's in charge of, which is nice.
Well, welcome to your first Curved Radio duties.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
It's fabulous to have you. And you're going to be talking about a place that's sort of like an iconic institution for teaching art in the United States, aren't you?
Yes. For my first kind of segment, I decided to do to talk about Black Mountain, North Carolina, because I've been doing mission controlling the Kipsey's Kickstarter there, and I thought it would be a good segue. In particular, I wanted to discuss the Black Mountain College, which puts the town on the map, and then the approaching start of the Black Mountain School, which is going to be essentially a redux of the spirit of the original Black Mountain College.
I thought that it had sort of closed. I know it started in about 1933-ish it started, and it's been going for a very, 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 very long time, and it's got a huge reputation. What happened to it?
Yeah, whatever happened to Black Mountain College is a good question, because it's, you know, it was founded in 1933 in the midst of the Depression, and it was the first of its kind. It viewed the most central aspect of liberal arts education to be John Dewey's principle of experience as art. And many of the teachers and students that were part of Black Mountain went on to become hallmarks of art when America ruled, you know, the decades after its post-war victory. So Buckminster Fuller, Robert Rauschenberg, Merce Cunningham, Charles Olson, John Cage,
Robert Creeley.
almost everyone that you could think of in American art that is avant-garde and famous probably had something to do with Black Mountain College. There's a good blog that your listeners might want to check out called Young Space. Young and space is one word, and it has a lot of good information for introductory information for beginners about Black Mountain College.
And so it's getting sort of a renewed life now. Is that what's happening?
Well, it's been kind of, I mean, they've been trying to give it a renewed life cosmetically ever since it closed in 1957. And I don't mean that in any bad way. I mean that in the way that these movements fall to kind of institutional museums of sorts. But what's been happening more and more lately is that, you know, the generations that have been born after the 80s, who have really had to deal with a heavy change in the way higher education is in America, have been so dissatisfied by living a life led with debt that people have been trying new solutions. So one is actually being started by Adam Boyd and Chelsea Reagan, two very important artists and collaborators of mine on this Kickstarter, and a lot of things that have been going on with Poughkeepsie for 10 years of existence. They'll be starting the Black Mountain School in the spirit of Black Mountain College. So the situation is very similar to the one that we had in 1933, where for-profit considerations overtake all others, and higher education in America is standardized. Tuition is increased to a point where most people have to take on a lifelong debt for just 4 years of college. So Black Mountain School is planned to be a non-curriculum, non-accredited environment of collective learning. Their first summer session will be in 2016, and it will be a month-long experiment.
Just a month.
just a month. But I mean, they're really like it's not how we think of schools. I mean, at all. It'll be about 50 people. The first time will be a month. Mostly, this is because of funding issues. I mean, Black Mountain College had a lot of a lot of wealthy backers, and Black Mountain School is basically going to be a DIY, like, crowd, you know, very small crowd funded from the beginning, and it's going to grow slowly. And they want to see what they can do. I mean, the first month will be, you know, they're definitely going to do it. They're going to have a kind of an October, like 2 weeks in October, they've invited several leading artists and thinkers of the day, like Joe Ahern from New York's Clock Tower Gallery, Marcus Sevens, who's a graduate dean of faculty at Maryland Institute College of Arts, Celie Daly, who's a video artist and founder of the experimental cassette tape music label Spew Geyser, which some of your listeners may be familiar with. And everyone's going to get down there together and kind of plan out what that first month is going to look like. So there's really kind of a community democratic guided principle here to the learning, just like there was in the original Black Mountain College.
This is going to be a very, very interesting thing to be watching. And I so hope that it works, because we so need to change things in the education system. I mean, we're starting to follow suit in Australia, where education is becoming so expensive that you can't. It's going to be for the rich people in Australia. And I suspect that's what's happening in the States, is it? Unless you want to end up with a lifelong debt.
Well, it's already happened in the States. I mean, in the States, it's, you know, you either are from a position where you can afford that kind of education, or you take on a lifelong debt, or you default on the debt, as I did, and then, you know, they just kind of consider you a non-citizen. Worst off, it's for the arts, because arts in America already are suffering terribly. But the shift has been in America, you know, higher education in America, away from the arts and more towards the sciences and the businesses and anything that can make you, I guess, money, mm-hmm. or anything that like is tangible. And art is just not very respected in America at all. And part of that may have something to do with the fact that so many of the institutions have gone crazy with the amount of money that they're obsessed with.
It's just weird, isn't it? It's just totally weird. I don't get it.
I mean, it is weird. I mean, it's also like it's like a disease. It's kind of the manifestations of a disease. People, you know, when the Charleston shooting happened, I mean, that was just one manifestation of one disease that really kind of has affected America's soul. America is losing its soul, and it's coming out in a lot of ways. And the arts really is kind of, the arts are where we find our soul. And I would gauge to bet that, you know, having abandoned the arts as America in the mainstream has done, for kind of the vapidness and kind of, you know, silliness and stupidity of corporate culture, is really what's at root for all the violence that we've been seeing here. The tyranny of business, or business as tyranny, which is basically what America has become, business as tyranny, it naturally comes with the destruction of art, or breeding art, you know, any kind of inclinations towards the arts out of people. Also, I think with cultural shifts in society, where it went from aristocracy to kind of, you know, nouveau riche in America, you know, a lot of the values have been lost. And some of those values were, you know, bad values like censorship, but a lot of the values were good values. And we don't talk about that. We don't talk about a patronage of the arts that America's, wealthiest families are responsible for. I mean, we don't like the Guggenheims, you know. Mm-hmm. So that kind of went away. I mean, that kind of went away with the shift of values.
Remy, how's the book going? And how's the Kickstarter campaign going for the book?
Well, thank you for asking, Gail. We have 18 days left in the campaign, and it's 31% closer to the goal. Now, a lot of Kickstarters make it in the last 2 weeks. Some make it in the last few days. Actually, most, I would say, make it in the last 2 weeks. 31% is really on par with successful Kickstarter trends. It really, really, really depends on that audience of the people of which your listeners are a part of. If this is really one of these moments where, you know, people can make something or can break something, because unfortunately it's the resource issue around the book has become so stressed and so strenuous that I think that if the Kickstarter were not to be successful, which I know it will be, I think that would seriously jeopardize the book, and most surely jeopardize that non-corporate example that the book has been setting,
which is really crazy. I mean, the raves it's been getting, and the fact that now, correct me if I'm wrong, but the guy who sort of got Catcher in the Rye published He was one of your main supporters?
Well, the main editor for the book, he wasn't the publisher, but he was kind of
he was the publisher. Champion, yeah. He was the one who made it happen, wasn't he?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. It was a man by the name of Barney Rossett, and Barney is one of the most influential people in the 20th century in American history. He basically gave America its canon of literature post the war, with Samuel Beckett, Henry Miller, William S. Burroughs, Malcolm X, and Trina Poughkeepsie is the last in this line of books. And people can save it by donating $5, $10, telling their friends $20, learning about the campaign. We've done a really exciting Kickstarter, and we're going to reveal in the last 2 weeks who is going to be writing the intro for the book.
Ah.
And I think that will get a lot of people excited.
Rami, how can people support you? Where do they go? What do they do?
People can support the Kickstarter campaign by going to Kickstarter.com and typing in Train to Poughkeepsie. Poughkeepsie is spelled P-O-K-I-P-S-E. Sharing it on their social media, telling their friends. If anyone has contacts to press, if anyone writes blogs or know people that write blogs, sharing the story with them. You can get in touch with me at my email, Rami, R-A-M-I, period, S-H-A-M-I-R, at Gmail, if you need me to send a press release or kind of have any press leads. And we really have 18 days left. So these 18 days are really kind of when things have to kind of go into full force if this is going to happen.
Yeah. Rami, I wish you the best of luck with it, and I'm looking very much forward to your next curvy crew duties, because we're loving what you're doing, mate.
Thank you, and I love what you guys are doing so much, and I love that you've been such a big supporter of this campaign. I'll tell you that there have been several backers that have come to the Kickstarter campaign because of your support and because of your illumination of it.